All right, well, good morning, everyone. I'm Michelle Pettit. I'm one of the members of the Conference Executive Committee, and I have the great honor and pleasure today to present to you a very esteemed panel of admirals from the Navy. We're going to talk about the rule of law in the Pacific Fleet. And from your perspective, you might say, well, you know, why do we care? We're here in Anaheim in this beautiful conference center in the AC. You know, why does it matter what's going on out there in the big, wide Pacific Ocean? Well, I mean, it's important for us to realize that the Pacific Fleet covers 3 oceans, 6 continents, and more than half of the Earth's surface. And the Navy and the United States military has a huge presence in that area. This is an area of a hotbed of issues, and it is really ground zero for a lot of rule of law issues. Now, most people think about the military in terms of the law of armed conflict, but the day-to-day operations of the Navy is really the preservation of the rule of law. And the entire history of the Pacific Fleet, it started with protection of commercial trade, and even to this day, that's exactly what we're doing. And so I think it's really important for us to understand that perspective. Particularly with the Ninth Circuit, if you look across the Ninth Circuit, every one of our states and territories has a huge military presence. You have a lot of military that is driving your economies in your local areas. You have a lot of military members that are appearing before you in court. And so it actually has a really direct effect on us. And I don't know if you've ever wondered, for those folks who don't have military experience, if you've ever wondered, where are all of our military members going when they deploy? What are they doing? And that's what we're going to discuss today, specifically in terms of the rule of law. Now, I want to give us a quick overview just so you kind of have a perception of how large the Navy is. You know, I just gave you a slide of all the military presence. We're going to talk specifically about the Navy, given the fact the Pacific Fleet is very instrumental in the rule of law in that area of the world. Navy personnel, and this is statistics as of last week. We've got over 300,000 strong with active duty members. Our ready reserve is over 97,000, with 57,000 are the active reservists that drill, our weekend warriors that get called up very quickly. In terms of the Marine Corps, was not able to find the statistics for the Marine Corps in 2018, but in 2017, they were 184,000 strong. And I will say this now, the Marines, yes, you were part of the Department of the Navy for all those Marines out there. And the Marines are an incredible partner with the Navy. We truly are one big naval force, and they deploy right alongside the naval vessels. As of last week, we are 284 ships that are active across the United States and worldwide. And we have 3 current aircraft carriers that are deployed with their battle groups with them. We have 3 amphibious assault ships that are currently underway, and we have over 3,700 aircraft that are operational, with the Marine having over 1,300. Now, I'm going to put this caveat here now. All of this information I'm providing you is unclassified. You all are fine to hear this information. I'm not giving you anything that you could not find online. And I purposely went online to find this information so that I made sure I didn't give you anything that was not privileged information. And everything that we say today, I have to make this caveat, is our own personal opinion. We are not here to represent the Navy or any political point of view. We're here just to give you an overview of things based on our experience. So in terms of what you might see in your own districts, when ships deploy, they deploy in certain fleets. They're organized in an operational structure. But from your perspective, when you're seeing the military members in your districts, they're based in certain bases. And the bases are organized by regions. We have the region Northwest, Southwest, Hawaii, and Guam, and the Northern Mariana Islands. And what I've done here is I want to just give you guys a representation of these different regions so you can see exactly where they are in your district. I have done just a full-on copy from each of the regions. I asked each region to give me what they have as their representation of their maps and their statistics. So this is what they publicize. Here in the Northwest region, Washington has got a huge amount of military presence up in Everett. And you can see that they've got 4 bases, with a Whidbey Island and Everett being the largest, with a very large submarine presence and aircraft carriers and surface ships, as well as a huge presence of aircraft. When you move down to the Southwest region, all those in California, you know, we have a huge military presence in San Diego, the largest concentration on the West Coast. But it's not just San Diego. You also have Camp Pendleton, a big, large Marine Corps concentration, just actually kind of the midway point between here and San Diego. And we also have multiple inland bases where we do a lot of research, training, and as well as our aircraft. We have several air bases internal in California and Nevada. Hawaii. So Hawaii is small geographically, but very large in terms of military presence. We have a joint operation base, Pearl Harbor and Hickam Air Force Base are now our joint base in Hawaii with a large presence of military, many Marines. And Kauai has got a huge presence in terms of research and training. So Hawaii is a very critical area for the military and Pacific Fleet. That's where a lot of the training occurs. And it's kind of the stopover point as ships head out to the Pacific Fleet. Now, I'm sure everybody knows where Guam is, but here I want to give you a representation. There is a joint region as opposed to a Navy region in the Marianas. And so that little circle of islands there, that's Northern Marianas Islands, which is they are represented here at this conference, and Guam. And you can see geographically, you can see that little dot of Hawaii, and then you see the bigger landmass there, China. That is a very strategically important area of the world. And that's in the Ninth Circuit. That's us. And so they are very important. So Naval Base Guam doesn't have a large concentration of ships. They do have a couple of submarines, a submarine tender, and some military sea lift ships that support the fleet. But it is a very critical spot for the Pacific Fleet. I even know from my experience when I was on active duty years ago, transiting the Pacific Ocean, going out to the Persian Gulf, we had engineering issues, and we spent 2 weeks in Guam. I know that's hard duty, right? 2 weeks in Guam. But they had the full capacity to do whatever they needed to do to repair our ship. And so Guam is a very critical base. And in Guam itself, in that small island of Guam, has got both an Air Force base as well as the naval base. I want to throw in here real quick also Navy region Japan. Now, obviously, Japan is not part of the Ninth Circuit, but when we talk about the Pacific Fleet, Japan is really critical. We have a huge presence, obviously, in Japan. This, and I put this slide is directly from the Navy region Japan's website, their PowerPoint, which shows you that most of their bases are joint bases with the Japanese and their forces. So that is a critical area for the United States to be part of. So what I want to do real quickly is I'm going to give you the quickest rendition of the history of the Pacific Fleet that you probably will have ever heard. In our materials that we provided you, we have the full recitation of all the history, which is quite interesting. But I'm going to give you a snippet in a couple of minutes. To start the history, you have to realize the birth date of the Navy is October 13, 1775, before the Declaration of Independence. The Pacific Fleet didn't actually come into existence until 1907, but in 1821 was the first Pacific Squadron that was established. And it's important to note that it was established for the purpose of protecting commercial shipping, which really is establishing customs and norms to protect the rule of law for trade. In 1854 was the first diplomatic and trade relations with Japan. And then post-Civil War, the Pacific Fleet, at the time Pacific Squadron, was conducting anti-piracy operations in the Gulf of California, very much rule of law operations. The Spanish-American War in 1895, we saw an expansion of the Pacific Squadron to engage in that conflict. And then the Pacific Squadron merged with another squadron to become the official Pacific Fleet in 1907 on April 15th. On February 1st, 1941, the Pacific Fleet established its headquarters in Pearl Harbor, and that's where it is today, the official headquarters. And only 10 months later, on December 7th, 1942, was the attack on Pearl Harbor. Did I say, you're right, that was a mistake, it was 1941, because that's not 10 months, is it? Thank you for correcting me. September 2nd in 1945, was when the Japanese surrendered, and at that point in time, there were 6,768 naval vessels in service, most of them in the Pacific. And that's a really interesting statistic looking at our 284 ships today. In June 25th of 1950, the North Korean troops invaded South Korea, and then the very next day, June 26th, the Pacific Fleet was involved with airstrikes and amphibious assaults. In the Vietnam conflict, by the mid-1960s, we were 200 strong in terms of ships from the Pacific Fleet involved in the conflict in Vietnam. And post-Vietnam era, we really saw an effort to have more engaged operations and training with our allied naval forces. And that's what you will see a lot today. As we sit here today, there is an operation going on, a training in Hawaii, what we call REMPAC, that happens every year, that has naval forces, allied forces, that all join together just for those exercises. On August 4th, 1990, Operation Desert Shield began, and our ships were involved in the Persian Gulf and North Arabian Sea. And after 9/11, as you know, we had Operation Enduring Freedom and Operation Iraqi Freedom that our forces were involved with as well. Now, one other note that's not up there that I think is really important that no one really thinks about. In the early 90s, the Navy really got involved in humanitarian efforts. So there is many deployments, even today, that when a naval vessel goes out, they're not doing anything related to war fighting. They are out there for humanitarian relief. So anything that has happened in the Pacific Fleet in that region since the 1990s, and there's been any type of natural disaster, the Navy has been there, giving medical aid, evacuating personnel, helping in any way they can. And in some cases, it's the United States Navy that's been the first on scene. In areas like Bangladesh, Philippines, Somalia, Indonesia, East Timor, Vietnam, the Federated States of Micronesia, Japan, and I could continue on. Any natural disaster in the past couple decades, the Navy has been there. So with that, that's kind of the introduction to the program. So what we're going to have now is I'm going to introduce our speakers and let them each come talk about their areas of the rule of law in the Pacific Fleet. We're first going to talk about the challenges in the training and equipping of the fleet in response to real-world threats. And we're going to be hearing from Admiral Jonathan Greenert. Now, he retired as the Chief of Naval Operations. So those non-military types, what that means is he's the grand poobah of the Navy. He was in charge at his retirement of every ship, every sailor, everything with the Navy that was under his command. He reported directly to the Secretary of the Navy and to the President of the United States as the Commander-in-Chief. So we are very honored to have him talk to us about how you train and equip the fleet. Rear Admiral Bob Guerrier, he had just retired like a year and a half ago, but prior to his retirement, he spent some time dealing with unmanned drone operations. But before that, he was the deputy commander of the Pacific Fleet, and he was dealing with all of these issues then that are still present today and has a very unique perspective. He is now the president of the Pacific Forum out in Hawaii, and he deals with these policy issues today. And then we're also very honored to have Vice Admiral Nanette Dorenzi. She's going to be talking about the legal challenges facing the fleet. Now, she is very honored to be the first female Judge Advocate General of the Navy. And when I say Judge Advocate General of the Navy, I mean the head Grand Poobah Attorney of the Navy. And she has a vast amount of experience in operational law, environmental law, and then as the Judge Advocate General of the Navy, she's the one who was dealing with all of the changes to the Uniform Court of Military Justice related to congressional mandate on sexual assaults, some major changes that happened in the military justice world. And she shepherded the JAG Corps into this new era of how we now prosecute cases. So she's got a vast amount of experience from operational law to the courts. So with that, I'm now going to turn this over to Admiral Greenert.
Thanks, Michelle. Thank you very much, Michelle, and thanks for the great rundown of the Navy, the laydown of the bases, and of course, what has been going on in the Pacific Fleet, the history. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure to be here. And for my friends from Guam, I say half a day. So, and by the way, the individual out there that found that error that we inserted this morning, we were gathering together, we said, we got to see if these people are paying attention. So let's put these are judges, you know, these are people that's what they do. So hats off to you, and give that person a prize. I'm not sure what it'll be, but you did well. So as Michelle indicated, I'm going to kind of give you the how. How do we deploy the fleet? And then Admiral Geary or Bob will talk about what it does along with Nan Durenzi. But to be clear, this is the largest fleet by far in the United States Navy. In fact, it is the largest fleet in the world and the largest that the world has ever seen. The majority of the, when I use the term forces, think ships, aircraft, people, submarines, underwater drones, if you will, airborne drones, SEAL teams, all of that combined in a collective term, forces. Half of all of the ships at any given day that we deploy are in the Western Pacific. It is that important. So the notional number, if you want notional numbers, we have about 300 ships, and at any given time, 100 are deployed, about one-third, and 50 of those are in and around the Western Pacific. It has been that way for decades. It is that important to us as we look out there. So our 4 out of 6 of our treaties, our obligations for protection, for partnerships, are in the Pacific. As you probably know, the largest economies and the largest emerging economies are in the Pacific. The challenges, the predominant challenges for us today, other than maybe Russia, although it's in the Pacific, those are all in the Pacific. And the potential, great potential for this nation, and really for the global economy, is in the Pacific. So really briefly, what is the mission of the Pacific Fleet? The mission of the fleet is a reflection of the mission of the Department of Defense and the mission of the military in general, which is, number one, defend the United States and its citizens. Number two, it is about the economy, stupid. It's about the global economy and keeping that flow of products, of goods in and around the world to keep the global economy going, if you will. Most of our treaty obligations are out there, as I said, and meeting those treaty obligations is number two. Number three, we need to reassure our allies, to work with them. At the same time, we need to dissuade or deter any potential adversaries and see to it that would be a bad mistake to upset what we just talked about, the importance of there. Responding to crises is the last one. And Michelle mentioned humanitarian assistance, disaster relief. That is the predominant crisis that occurs in the Pacific. From volcanoes, you know, the Ring of Fire resides out there. Volcanoes, tsunamis, typhoons, and pandemics. The most recent pandemics we've had, other than the Ebola in Africa, have been in the Pacific. So why deploy forces? Some people say, this is crazy. It's too expensive. Why do we do this? Let's have ready forces, keep them in the continental United States, and we'll go forward if we need to. Well, that sounds like a good concept. Number one, you'll be late for almost anything happening in the world today. But number two, and perhaps the real reason is, hey, at the end of World War II, we emerged as the superpower, the guarantor of peace throughout the world. We had requirements in Europe, their NATO, and we had hundreds of thousands of our folks over there for many decades before we brought that down. We have forces in the Mideast and had for 70 years. We have been in Bahrain, which many people don't realize, for over 70 years in that partnership. And of course, in the Pacific, as Michelle laid down, in Japan, in Korea, and in Singapore, we have requirements out there, obligations to meet, and that's why we deploy. It's to really keep the threat to this nation away from the continental United States. And that's a part of why 9/11 was so devastating for so many reasons, but we had not been attacked on soil, as Michelle mentioned, since Pearl Harbor. So providing that presence forward to deploy, there are two real means they ought to think about. One is the forward deployed concept. What I mean by that is in those locations that Michelle mentioned, we actually send forces, remember all those things that are involved, to places forward in Japan, in Korea, in Guam, and in Singapore for sometimes a few years, 3, 4, 5 years at a time, in cooperation with a host government. That's the forward deploy concept. But most of all in deployment, it involves rotational deployment. Some forces go forward for 6 or 7 months at a time, and there's a process to get this concept working so that they're on time, they have the right skill sets, and I'll talk to that in just a minute. That process that lays down the forces, if you will, the United States forces around the world, is called the Global Force Management Scheme. It is run by the Secretary of Defense, who has delegated that authority and that responsibility from the President of the United States. Now, the department breaks down, if you will, the world into global regions, and one of them, of course, is Pacific Command. Another, African Command, Central Command in the Middle East, Northern Command, that's the continental United States, Southern Command, Latin America, European Command, all kind of makes sense if you think about it. But that's the way the Department of Defense thinks about the areas of the world that they have to provide forces, be prepared to provide forces, and those people who are in charge, the Grand Imperial Poobahs of those areas, using your term, are called the Geographic Combatant Commanders. In the Pentagon and in Washington, the services, Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, and their requisite service chiefs, where I served at one time, they provide the forces to go out to these locations, and those forces are commanded and are responsible for their well-being, if you will, and their actions by these Global Combatant Commanders. I'll call them GCCs now. Now, in the mid-1980s, there was a pretty important law to the Department of Defense, the Goldwater-Nichols Act. And part of what that did, it distinguished between what the GCCs do and what the services do. And simply put, the services organize, train, equip, and provide forces to the GCCs. Simple concept, if you will. And it separates that so that you don't have folks making bad decisions because, well, I don't have enough money, we're not going to do that, or I have more, so we're going to go do that, and get away from sort of an oversight and a breakdown between each and every service doing something a little bit different. So you would have individuals responsible for specific areas around the world. It provided a nice creative tension where the services were told, how many forces do I need, what kind of readiness level, how long do I need them over there, and for what reason. And that debate emerges in the Pentagon, and in the budget is formed together, and that goes over to the legislative branch. So each of these services have service components. So for example, in the Navy and in Pacific Compact Fleet, the Pacific Fleet is the component of the Navy which serves Pacific Command. There's an Army Command in the Pacific, an Air Force Command in the Pacific, a Marine Corps Command in the Pacific. And if you march around the world to the different geographic areas I told you about, each of those has a component. And that componency is a very important part of this. It's a little bit of a broker, a little bit of a moderator between what the Geographic Combatant Commander needs and what the services say they can provide. And also that service component, Pacific Fleet, organizes, trains, and also equips the forces to help prepare them to deploy. So this process in the Navy to prepare forces to deploy, it's called the Fleet Response Plan. The name's irrelevant. There's a similar name that the Army has, the Air Force has, and the concept works very much the same between all of them. It produces forces. That's the end state of the Fleet Response Plan. People and platforms, as I said before, forces that are ready to be tasked for a whole spectrum of operations. That spectrum of operations is defined by the Department of Defense, like I said, based upon the input of the geographic commanders. Now, the readiness of those things that we send forward on deployment, that is the highest readiness that we can put together in our plan. Those folks are ready. They're at the highest level of their skills for that 7 months because they've got to be ready to deal with just about anything out there. But the process prepares what I'll call a tiered readiness. In other words, folks are worked up, if you will, for deployment. They get at a higher and higher level of readiness. And then after they deploy, they are sustained for a period of time. And I'll talk in a minute about what that means at a little bit reduced readiness. So they could ramp up if need be, if you have to go to war, if you have an operation, you know, Iraqi Freedom or anything like that, or if you have to respond locally in and around the continental United States, those forces that are back here in San Diego and up in the Pacific Northwest would react to any kind of crises here in the continental United States. So the fleet response plan, it has a cycle. It's 36 months long. In simple terms, it's kind of set around what we call the carrier strike group. And Michelle alluded to it. Simply put, a carrier strike group is the aircraft carrier, about 5,000 people, an air wing, about 90 aircraft with 3,500 people, and they join together. They form that carrier strike force, if you will, there on the carrier. In concert with it and operating with it are five surface combatants. They run in the order of 400 feet, 300 people, a lot of sensors, a lot of weapons. I won't bog you down with what that is. Two nuclear submarines. They have about 150 people on each. And then you have to have an oiler to provide aviation fuel. The carriers are nuclear powered, but you need aviation fuel. You need to support the destroyers. You need food. You need supplies. You need extra ammunition. Those all form and work together to deploy and go through this cycle I called the fleet response plan. The process, if I were to put it in simplified terms, it's about that time of year, the NFL training camps have opened. All right, so what happens when the National Football League, and you have two right up the road here, right, get together and get their teams ready to do the season? Well, they have an off season where they get their surgeries done, they modernize, they change, they make trades. And in the fleet response plan, that's called the maintenance phase. Our airplanes go into a deep maintenance. Our ships go into dry dock, many of them, and they're all getting maintained. It's about 6 months long. And then you have a training phase. In the NFL, you come to, in the springtime, you have spring drills. And then you show up for training camp. And the tight ends go over there, the linemen go over there, the quarterbacks go over there, and review and hone their basic skills. In the Navy, the ships go through the basic seamanship area, the aircraft, the pilots are flying, simplistic things getting more and more complex, going through a basic phase to an advanced phase to an integrated phase to really a capstone event where you bring that whole carrier strike group together and you're evaluated. Just like in the NFL, you'll go through preseason, get that last preseason done, do your final cuts, and you're ready for the season. In the Navy, in the fleet response plan, that season is the deployment. So again, about a 7-month piece, and that is the essence of what makes this work and pulls it all together to organize, train, equip the forces to send them forward. The product, again, are forces ready to do the job that they're told. They have to be able to integrate with other Navy groups of ships, if you will. You could take two carrier strike groups, form them into one. They have to have the command and control, the hierarchy, to do that. You have to integrate with joint forces. You have to work with the Air Force, with the Army. It depends on what the tasking is, and they have to be ready to do that, so we have to certify them to do that. The mission can evolve. It's not unusual, and recently the aircraft carrier Nimitz left the West Coast, went to the Pacific, was tasked to go over the Arabian Gulf. And before they were ready to come home, after 7.5 months, they were in the Red Sea providing strikes over in Syria to combat ISIS. So it's an evolving mission. As you might imagine, in simplistic terms, what are the challenges of getting this done? Well, number one, a budget. You've got to have the right budget. It has to be well-defined, and it has to be on time. And the reason it has to be on time is because when those ships go in maintenance to start that cycle, they have to enter on time, they have to exit on time. You have to have an industrial base and a companionship, or if you will, a partnership, and you have to be reliable enough to be able to put things under contract on time and get it done. You need a predictable schedule. You need to know when do we need to be, when do we need to have these forces, how long, and again, what skill set, but without a predictable schedule for when they're going to be over there, it's hard to pull it together the way you need to. And then lastly, you have to have the right trained people with the right skill set falling in and coming into those units when they're ready to go. So you pull all that together, and that is how you prepare the forces to go forward. Here are the forces. They're out on deployment. It's got a regimen. It's got a scheme. And I'll now ask Bob Geerier to come up and say, okay, that's all fine, but what do they do over there, and what are the challenges? So thank you very much for listening.
Well, thanks, Michelle and Admiral Greenert for setting the stage. as we continue this this discussion and walk you through what Pacific Fleet's life is about. Before I begin, I just want to say it's a pleasure to be here to address this very distinguished group and hopefully share with you what the challenges are that the Pacific Fleet faces. And the way I'm going to do that, continuing on what's already been built by Michelle and Admiral Greenert, is to kind of show the layers, the context, and we're going to start stacking them up, so to speak, so you get this whole picture, and it builds towards this notion that rule of law is in tension, that there are forces out there that are tugging at this, and all the things that we hold dear. So first, to begin, I want to talk about the physical environment, and this overlaps a little bit, but it's good to reinforce. And then we'll neck down into some more specifics. So this first slide that you see here is some of the elements that we've already talked about. It's a really big area, this Pacific, this Indo-Asia-Pacific, which we increasingly talk about it in those terms because that more accurately captures the whole region. Now, many of the things that I talk about here, they apply globally. You may say, well, geez, that happens everywhere. I'll make the assertion, though, that in the Pacific, it's particularly acute because so many things come together here. It becomes this incredible palette, quite frankly, of competition, of tension, and you can see it play out. So the physical dimensions. We talk about the tyranny of distance. You hear that term a lot. What does that mean? Well, it means, quite frankly, it takes a long time to get to places, days, weeks. And once you get there, it takes a lot to sustain your forward presence. Admiral Greenert talked about fuel. Well, there's food, there's the communication links. There's all the things that we take for granted that you have here in the continental United States, but then you're bringing it forward to a strange place, sometimes a threatening and a hostile place, quite frankly. You know, if you were to take the continental United States, just imagine the 50 contiguous states, that is, and you were to stack up that picture, that visual, I think you can almost put about 8 of them in that expanse from the West Coast over towards the West Coast of India. 70% of the Earth, as we know, covered with water. 90% of our global commerce is conducted by sea. In this Indo-Asia-Pacific region, 52% of the world's population, at least, more, actually. 1/3 of all trade, 1/2 of all of our oil trade. 12 of the 20th busiest airports. 7 of the 10 largest cities in the world, 10 of the 20 largest GDP economies. So much happens here. You talk about the rebalance to the Pacific that had been declared several years ago. It was an acknowledgement of how much of what happens in the world really emerges in this area. I'd like to make the point that it can be a really tough neighborhood when you talk about the folks that reside here. You've got quite a mix. You've got the largest democracy in terms of population, India. You've got one of the largest democracies in terms of area, Indonesia, now again becoming more and more increasingly democratic. You have autocratic states that are ruled by one party, essentially one party systems, China and Russia being the largest. Nuclear weapon states, China, Russia, whether they're declared or undeclared, North Korea, India, Pakistan on the border again, which is actually outside this region, but it borders on it. You have modern militaries that are growing rapidly in some cases, with forces that are increasingly lethal. There's a proliferation of missile technology, missiles with longer ranges, faster speeds, stealthier platforms, whether they're ships or aircraft that launch them. And there's the capability to increasingly hold at risk larger and larger areas of territory, whether it be airspace or sea. And these are all the trend lines, and they're continuing to go in the positive direction in terms of more and more capability. There's new types of warfare. And I'm going to get into that a little bit more when we talk about about how you wage war and the ability to really conduct conflict at thresholds even below what we would normally consider military conflict. And again, I'll get into that in a little bit more detail later. As mentioned earlier, you've got five of our allies. You've got alliances with Japan, the Republic of Korea, the Philippines, Thailand, by the way, which is the oldest alliance we have in that region, Australia as well. So there's commitments that we have there. There's also the Taiwan Relations Act, not an alliance, but essentially an act, of course, and then memorandums of understanding that communiques that also add texture to that particular act and what we believe we're committed to. So on top of all those relationships, you've got the absence of a completely multilateral security architecture. There is no NATO that exists in this part of the world. Instead, you have a web of relationships, bilateral, trilateral, and sometimes multilateral. And there is a desire to try to grow towards that more multilateral approach. On the next slide, you see that's the world, in this part of anyway, that's connected by trade routes. So those lines right there, actually, that's a view from space of automated information system, AIS, tracks, transponders from ships that are over 300 tons. And it creates a picture. So again, that's not just a graph of where the routes are. Those are actual contacts over time that creates a picture. That's the power of this particular shot. And I'll leave it up there as I speak because it really starts to talk about how connected we are and how the world is shrinking. And we already talked about the facts and figures about that part of the world with so many powers and technology that's increasing and the aspirations that go with it. Imagine, if you will, I don't have the overlay, but imagine air routes on top of that. You see them when you're flying around and you pull out Hemisphere magazine right there in a United flight or whatever and you see all those lines. Well, imagine that on top of that. And then you start to see the density where the Pacific Fleet operates, its ships, its aircraft, submarines. And that this gives you the context for the playing field, if you will, where tension and this tug of war, if you will, goes and takes place. So with those routes comes an expectation of throughput for trade. Time is money. And with that comes a system of rights and the freedom of movement and access. You know, there's a reason for this. It supports our entire global supply chain. Whether it's our trade or someone else's, it's entirely connected. So that's the so what factor of those trade routes you often hear about. It's what gets everything to us, and not just us, but the world. And so you have that in tension with the adjacent nations that are in this region. And it's their territorial claims, whether it be 12-mile territorial limits, and some of those are disputed, out to 24 contiguous zone, out to the EEZ, the economic exclusive zones. You have ambiguous claims in this area, one in particular by China, the 9-dash line. And we'll talk more about that later. But there's a lot of conflict in this area and dispute. I mean, even the names of the seas in this area, I'll start from north to south. You know, there's the Yellow Sea. Well, it depends who you talk to. I mean, there's broadly recognized names, but there's always under dispute. But the Koreans will call that the West Sea. There's the Sea of Japan. We've all heard of that. Again, from a Korea perspective, that's the East Sea, again, relative to the peninsula. As you move into the South China Sea, if you talk to the Philippines, they'll say, no, that's the West Philippine Sea. Or Indonesia will refer to the South China Sea as the North Natuna Sea because it recognizes the EEZs of some of the islands that Indonesia cares about and doesn't wish to just write off and say, no, that's all Chinese. So that's the neighborhood where you're always, everything is in tension, and it's pretty important. Air Defense Identification Zones, ADIZ is the shorthand. I won't get into too much jargon here, I promise. But those are areas that are used for control of airspace. You know, the U.S. has had them for many, many years. We had them back in World War II. Korea and Japan established them later. China established one several years ago, but it was uncoordinated and became very disruptive, and still is, because it overlaps other ADIZs from Japan, from Korea, Taiwan as well. So why do we care about that? You know, what's the so what again about these territorial claims? It isn't just the resources, but it's sovereignty, and then jurisdiction that extends from that sovereignty, and then influence. And different nations view those things in different ways and wish to exert them in various degrees. Sometimes compliant with international norms and customs, sometimes not so much. Meanwhile, you have this reality, this throughput, this need that has to happen all the time. And so now I'm beginning to hopefully paint this picture of why we have a fleet that's out there, that's forward, to defend these things, because it becomes very complex very, very rapidly. One more slide I'll show. And again, these are just, think of these as additive overlays. The one on the upper left corner there that you're looking at, those are undersea cables. So again, you see the density. It's hard to see because the scale of that particular chart. But again, these really come into play. They overlap. You know, they're on the seabed. They provide communication lines, the connectivity that keeps the global economy moving. Just one more piece of intersecting, overlapping, connecting linkages that needs to be able to exist in a free and unrestricted environment. And that's the so what factor. And then you think about the bottom slide there with those green shaded areas. And those depict, because I don't expect you to be able to, you can't read the legend, of course, but those are areas of resources. You know, millions of barrels of oil or gas. And you see the green shaded areas. The darker the shade, the more there is there. So there's resources there. And of course, that entire region is bordered by some seven different nations. Or states that have overlapping claims. And they see that as their wealth, as their future. And so that's intention. So that's the physical environment that I've attempted to describe, to outline. There's also a strategic and an operational environment. And we talk about it, our source documents that I like to use is the National Security Strategy, written in December of 17. The National Defense Strategy came out in early in 2018. And those documents, they talk about overt challenges to the free and open international order. Again, the so what behind these pictures. And the reemergence of long-term strategic competition and the rapid dispersion of technologies, new concepts of warfare, and competition that spans the entire spectrum of conflict. Those last two points, I told you I wanted to come back to new concepts of warfare. And because technology has enabled us to do many things that we couldn't do before, how you think about warfare and how you think about conflict now has much more subtlety to it. In the past, we had traditional domain-centric warfare, air, surface, subsurface, pretty much those three areas. Now you're talking about cross-domain, because technology enables you to do things from one domain to the other. So this is now a blurring of the lines. Why? Because you can, because technology has enabled it. But there are also new domains. We talk about the seabed nowadays. That's why the picture of the undersea cables is so important. You talk about space. So really, the domains we talk about now go from seabed to space and everything in between. And then, of course, the man-made, the domain of cyber, which has been a focus of discussion this entire week, and certainly in the headlines. And how you think about information warfare, and no longer just the domain of militaries, again, that's in the headlines continuously. So those are all the things now, domains, that the playing field has enlarged. But even the variety of actors, you've got state actors, you've got non-state actors, you have military units, paramilitary units, non-military units, often called gray forces. So they're in play. And then you have the things that all these, either whether it's the domains and the actors, then can achieve. You know, when we use the term kinetic and non-kinetic, you know, does it blow up or not? You know, that's the simple parlance of things. But there's lethal, there's non-lethal. There's reversible and irreversible effects that you can create. There's attributable and non-attributable. So now you're seeing that these degradations of how you choose to engage in conflict has really grown. There's conventional, non-conventional. Weapons of mass destruction we've talked about for many years. There's treaties in place. And I'd offer weapons of mass effect that we now see as well, and how you deal with all these things. So there's another layer of conflict. Just the means and the domains of which it can play out has increased an order of magnitude. So some more aspects to think about. The history in this area. The memories from World War II, they're still there. There's a need to build trust. There's unresolved conflicts that still reside. The Korean Peninsula, of course, is probably the largest one. So what's our operational enduring mission of the Pacific Fleet out here? Well, I can simply tell you, it's all about maintaining stability and security. And for what purpose? In the interest of prosperity. That's an eminently reasonable thing. And many of our allies and partners, we all stack hands on that, because that's what it's about. Stability and security in the interest of prosperity. A free and open Indo-Asia Pacific, those are words that you hear. And that's the case. That's the so what and the why. And our national defense strategy talks about it. So then you may say, okay, well, stability and security, what's challenging that other than those circumstances you talked about? So there's some hot spots and areas where the friction is continually grinding. I'm going to run through a bunch of them real fast here. There's the North Korean Peninsula, and we're seeing the efforts that are in play today that hopefully will be successful, but everyone walks into those negotiations with their eyes wide open. There's the Taiwan, unresolved Taiwan situation, and our commitments there, and about cross-strait relations and how that's peacefully resolved. There's the South China Sea and the Nine Dash Line and how that gets resolved and what that large, ambiguous claim really means. Is it defensible? And I won't say any more about that. I'll save that for the next speaker. There's the East China Sea and there's gas oil fields that the Chinese and the Japanese are disputed. These are friction points. There's the uncoordinated air defense identification zone declarations that overlap with existing ones. That's a source. And why is that a source of friction? It's not just a declaration. It's what you do inside that airspace, the interception of aircraft, civilian and military, and what the expectations are in that air defense. Now, again, the purpose of those is to, alert yourself, the country, to ingressing aircraft. It's their right to understand who's coming in and identify them. But what about aircraft that are traversing? Don't they have a right to unimpeded access? Goes back to that throughput and expectations for free movement. And there's your grinding point again. Freedom of navigation, that's an element, the air, but it's also at sea. And it includes the right to conduct surveillance. Again, another area of friction. Beyond the territorial seas of any nation, the U.S. and customary law allows our aircraft and ships to conduct surveillance. The Chinese Navy was disinvited from RIMPAC, as you all know, late spring. The exercise is currently taking place. But they sent one of their surveillance ships out there. And it's their right to do that, as long as they don't interfere with the exercise and observe international law. That's how it works. And we assert that same right in the Western Pacific. There's territorial disputes throughout the entire area, all the way from the north up on the Kuril Islands between Russia and Japan. In the Sea of the Japan itself, Lion Court rocks are disputed. The sovereignty is disputed. The control is with the Koreans. It's called Dokdo Island, or it's called Takashima, depending on, again, the different names, depending on who you are. There's terrorist activity in the Philippines and in Malaysia in particular. There's the threat of WMD proliferation. There are the natural disasters that Admiral Gunner talked about earlier that are increasing in frequency and severity each year, which that fleet, the Pacific Fleet, is often and many times, sometimes the first on scene outside support. That's flooding, that's earthquakes, it's tsunamis, it's typhoons. There's a whole issue of maritime security, of nations understanding what's happening in those spaces beyond their territorial seas, in their contiguous zones, in their EEZs. Do they even have awareness of what's happening out there? Can they maintain stewardship of those resources, their futures? There's a threat of major nuclear armed powers. Again, some are growing at fast rates and lack of transparency in what their intentions are. And then there's this notion of anti-axis or contesting spaces. And again, as those capabilities of increasing distance and more lethal systems, what is the intent behind that? Is the intent to keep people out? Is the intent to challenge those lifelines that the global economy, the supply chains rely on? So the approach of all this, to all these, is to deter. That's both conventional and nuclear deterrence. There's the homeland defense, which we believe in defending, but we often do that forward. The best way to defend at home is to take that and make it the away game. We assure our allies and partners. That's part of the missions that the PAC fleet is involved in, Pacific Fleet. We need to be prepared to defend against aggressive and overt acts from those major powers. Be ready to respond to crises that may pop up that are more about flashpoints, whether by accident or otherwise. You still need to respond to them and do that quickly. You want to build capability in your own forces using that process Admiral Greenert outlined, but also with your allies and partners. Think of building capability as the quality of what you can do. Then there's building capacity. How much of it can you do and for how long? Both your own ability and those of your allies and partners. There's building partnership and engagement. We do that with our exercises. And all these elements and all those lines of effort that I just ticked through, those are tools to help manage this tension, to be out and about, to assert those global views, those customary norms in the face of what's being challenged. We talked about in the national security strategy, in the national defense strategy. We want to prevent conflict. We want to shape that environment to keep it friendly to a world order, a post-World War II order that we fought and tens of millions of lives were lost, that upheld the rule of law, that upheld democratic self-determinations. And that takes all of the Navy. That takes all of our joint forces. And if you really want to do it right, it takes all of government, all of nation, and I'd add all of allies and partners. So the lines now have become blurred. How you think about conflict, what you need to help push back, and the expansive nature of this really never-ending competition. So I'm going to close by simply saying that's the backdrop. All these layers of activity, of connectivity, of tension that is providing the stage for this great power competition. And it's competition with China and with Russia. That's not a secret. It's competition where you continually have to assert your views, the world's views, the post-World War II views and order that allow this free transport, this throughput, this connectivity. And I think what we're seeing now is an era where you're seeing power versus rule of law in tension. And these elements, this rule of law is being challenged. So I'll leave it with that. We can go to the next slide, but I'll just leave it as a set piece, as the South China Sea and overlapping claims, to our next speaker, Admiral Dorenzi.
Well, good morning, everybody. And I'd like to thank Michelle for putting all of this together and thank all of you for inviting us and for listening to us talk about something that maybe you don't hear about all that often. I've never really heard myself referred to as the grand poobah of anything. And I'm not sure I'm really qualified to back cleanup with this group, but we'll see where we go. You know, you might have heard it said that when tensions arise anywhere in the world, the President of the United States says, where are the aircraft carriers? In an increasingly complex legal landscape, on a daily basis, the commanders have been known to say, where's my lawyer? And present company excluded, that question sometimes comes with a string of expletives associated with it, depending on what the question of the day is. And while that's particularly true in the matters that Admiral Guerrier just described, and that we're going to talk about in a few minutes, I'd be remiss if I didn't touch on the breadth of expertise required by and resident in the Navy's JAG Corps today. The traditional areas of practice remain, and like everything else, they're getting increasingly complicated. Military justice, bread and butter issues like legal assistance for sailors and their families, and administrative law. Emerging and evolving disciplines like cyber law and intelligence law are continuing to gain greater significance and importance. And environmental law is a good example of a legal discipline that crosses installation management, military training, and operations both at sea and ashore. It underpins our ability to train the way we fight and operate at sea and on land. It strives to preserve the use of our training ranges, to protect the various species resident on those ranges and on our installations. And it also serves as a hedge to further land development. It seeks to strike the right balance between compliance and responsible stewardship and the military readiness, as Admiral Greenert described, that our national security demands. So as you might imagine, there are still a lot of generalists in today's JAG Corps, but there's an ever-increasing need for lawyers with deep expertise in discrete subject areas. Our international lawyers, who kind of think of themselves as the stars of the show, they'd be the ones at the forefront in the topics that we're talking about today. And you've been sort of around the world. We spent time talking about the vast expanse of the Pacific Theater. I'm going to shrink it down and talk about the role and the effectiveness of the rule of law in the Pacific Theater, where the South China Sea provides a useful illustration of the natural tension between the rights of all nations to operate on the global commons and the sovereignty and jurisdictional rights of coastal states. As you've heard, China's engaged in territorial disputes in the South China Sea, and the South China Sea is depicted on the slide. When Admiral Greenert was the 7th Fleet commander forward deployed in Japan, and I was his JAG 14 years ago, the disputes were largely based in who controlled the resources, fisheries and minerals and such. And our concern over these disputes centered on their potential to cause tension and maybe incidents between China and its neighbors, like Japan and the Philippines, and our emerging partners, such as Vietnam. While that competition for resources remains, China's island-building activities in the Spratly Islands over the last several years is making the South China Sea an area of U.S. and Chinese strategic competition in a global context of renewed power competition. So how's the rule of law fit into this power dynamic? The United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, UNCLOS, is the comprehensive treaty regime that defines maritime zones and governs activities on, above, and below the world's oceans. In today's discussion, we'll talk about two of those maritime zones, territorial waters and the exclusive economic zone, or EEZ. So territorial waters extend 12 nautical miles from a coastal state's shoreline or offshore islands. And the coastal state exercises sovereignty over its territorial sea, the airspace above it, and the seabed and subsoil beneath it. Ships, both commercial and military, have the right of what we call innocent passage through another state's coastal territorial waters. Basically, that means you can drive from point A to point B continuously and expeditiously. Naval vessels can't conduct other activities. You can't do drills. You can't do intelligence collection. You can't launch and recover your aircraft. The EEZ, on the other hand, includes the territorial waters, but it extends about 200 nautical miles from a coastal state shore or offshore islands. It provides a coastal state with sovereign rights for exploiting, exploring, and conserving natural resources, and jurisdiction with regard to activities like marine scientific research and the protection and preservation of the maritime environment. Now, a key element of UNCLOS is the principle of freedom of the seas. Treatment of the world's seas under international law as a global commons. Sometimes that's referred to as freedom of navigation, but frankly, that can be viewed too narrowly to include simply the freedom to transit or navigate the seas, pass through sea areas, as opposed to the freedom for both commercial and naval vessels to conduct various activities at sea. So a more complete way to think about the freedom of the seas is that it encompasses all the rights, freedoms, and lawful uses of the sea and airspace, including by military ships and aircraft, that are guaranteed to all nations under international law. So China and about 168 other nations are parties to UNCLOS. The United States is not. Although the United States hasn't ratified UNCLOS, the U.S. government has long maintained that the provisions in UNCLOS represent customary international law, which the U.S. is committed to observing and asserting. China's nine-dashed line, depicted on the slide, illustrates not only China's excessive territorial claims, and claims that extend to minerals and fishing rights. But it also serves as a foundation of China's view that it can regulate the activities of foreign military forces operating in the EEZ. China and the United States are kind of like lawyers in this regard. We're going to look at the same document, the same treaty, and we're going to use it to argue our different positions. In a room full of lawyers, I know you can understand that. The United States has consistently asserted the right to conduct military activities in EEZs around the world. Our position is that while UNCLOS gives coastal states the right to regulate economic activities like fishing and oil exploration in their EEZs, it doesn't give coastal states the right to regulate foreign military activities in the EEZ beyond their 12 nautical mile territorial waters. China's position is that UNCLOS gives coastal states the right not only to regulate economic activities, but also foreign military activities in their EEZs. To the extent Chinese commentators make specific legal arguments based in UNCLOS, they typically start with the proposition that UNCLOS doesn't specifically permit military activities in the EEZ, and therefore those activities are prohibited without the coastal state's consent. China also claims that military activities in the EEZ conducted without the coastal state's consent violate another UNCLOS provision that requires states to refrain from any threat or use of force. Chinese commentators argue that U.S. military activities in the EEZ facilitate data collection that could be used at some point in the future to support military operations against China. Well, it's true. Information collection to the prejudice of the defense or security of the coastal state is prohibited, but it's prohibited in that state's 12 nautical mile territorial sea. No similar restriction applies in UNCLOS regarding the EEZ. It's silent about that. So when we read the UNCLOS, we believe we can send our air forces and naval forces into China's EEZ or anyone else's, and China can do the same in the U.S., as Admiral Guerrier noted. Ironically, and not surprisingly, China believes that too, and it does in fact send its military forces into other nations' EEZs, but it passed a domestic law criminalizing military activities by foreign entities in the EEZ. So the issue of whether China has a right to regulate foreign military activities related to territorial disputes in the South China Sea, accepting China's claims to sovereignty over the inhabitable islands there, could permit China to expand the EEZ within which China claims a right to regulate, read, forbid, military activities. Now, the United States has never taken a position on the competing claims to sovereignty over land features in the South China Sea. It does, however, take the position that those claims should be resolved peacefully, without coercion, intimidation, threats, or the use of force, and in a manner consistent with international law and norms. In 2013, the Philippines sought to do just that when it pursued arbitration under UNCLOS over the role of historic rights and the source of maritime entitlements in the South China Sea, the status of certain maritime features and the maritime entitlements they generate, and the lawfulness of Chinese actions that the Philippines alleged violated UNCLOS. A tribunal was constituted properly under UNCLOS to hear the case, although China stated repeatedly that it wouldn't accept or participate in the arbitration, and that, in its view, the tribunal lacked jurisdiction. China's non-participation didn't stop the tribunal from going forward, and 3 years later, the tribunal issued a ruling strongly in the Philippines' favor and strongly supporting the international norms that we strive to abide by and in that area. The tribunal ruled, among other things, that China's nine-dash line claim had no legal basis at all, that none of the land features in the Spratlys is entitled to anything more than 12 nautical mile territorial sea, that three of the Spratlys features that China currently occupies generate no entitlement to maritime zones at all, and that China violated Philippine sovereign rights by interfering with Philippine vessels, damaging the maritime environment, and engaging in reclamation works in what's the Philippines EEZ. Under UNCLOS, that award is binding on the Philippines and China, but there's no enforcement mechanism. The United States has urged China and the Philippines to abide by the award, but China declared the ruling null and void, and the Philippines mindful of the economic issues at play with China, hasn't significantly relied upon the tribunal's ruling in any meaningful way. So what's happening today, 2 years after that ruling? China continues to assert control over the area and its resources. Historically, trade, fishing rights, and the economic value inherent in that area. But a few years ago, China began to develop forward military bases in the South China Sea. China used dredging efforts to build up the reefs there and create man-made islands, destroying reefs in the process. Since that time, China's constructed military facilities on the islands with several bases, including hangars, barracks, underground fuel and water storage facilities, and bunkers. Recently, China deployed anti-ship cruise missiles, surface-to-air missiles, and jammers there. So the issue of concern coming to the fore now is the militarization of the Spratlys as a point of future power projection. The United States, for its part, is continuing to implement the Southeast Asia Maritime Security Initiative, which was an Obama-era initiative to improve the ability of the Philippines, Vietnam, Malaysia, and Indonesia to maintain their maritime domain awareness and patrol their EEZs. The United States has taken actions to increase U.S. defense and intelligence cooperation with Vietnam and Indonesia and increase our assistance to improve the maritime security capabilities of those two countries. We've also increasingly engaged in something called freedom of navigation operations. You know, with easements, if you keep walking in your neighbor's yard, eventually, you know, you've got a constructive easement there. Think of freedom of navigation operations the same way. The more you do it, you know, the more it becomes the customary norm. We didn't do many FON operations against China 14 years ago when Admiral Greenert and I were in the 7th Fleet. The United States is increasingly doing them now and transiting disputed areas to show that the international community hasn't accepted China's exaggerated claims. These operations support the general goal of defending the principle of freedom of the seas and the specific goal of refuting China's claims in the South China Sea. And as Admiral Geary described, in May, DOD disinvited China from participating in RIMPAC, something China had done in both 2014 and 2016. Traditionally, the United States engages in multilateral framework in the Pacific. China prefers to address maritime territorial disputes with other regional partners on a bilateral rather than a multilateral basis. And they're, you know, as the big dog in that block, you can understand why they feel that way. The Association of Southern Asian Nations, ASEAN, including Indonesia, Malaysia, Thailand, and Singapore, generally favor UNCLOS norms, and they're wary of China's territorial ambitions. While ASEAN and the United States' ability to influence China appear limited, bilateral engagement at the operational level, out where it's happening every single day, can help avoid confusion and avoid accidental, you know, the unintended consequences of everybody's presence in those competing claims and avoid conflict. So taken alone, UNCLOS is only one tool to bring to bear on these challenges. While its effectiveness in changing behavior may be limited because of the lack of enforcement provisions, the United States could ratify UNCLOS and take away China's biggest argument, which is that the United States has no standing at all to assert or defend rights under UNCLOS. I participated in a training trip several years ago, and we sat down in Beijing with Chinese academics, with Chinese naval officers, and with some owners of commercial shipping vessels. And they didn't realize that in our group was the Deputy Judge Advocate General of the Navy and the Judge Advocate General of the Coast Guard. And they started arguing over their interpretation of what UNCLOS means. Well, we came back at them, chapter and verse, which is something I could do, you know, several years ago, to refute their claims. And they said over and over again, you don't even talk to us. You don't have the right to talk to us about this because you're not part of it. And it was, I have to tell you, it was frustrating because that, you know, how do you answer that? And that's their fallback position. As you work through our interpretation of what those words mean, they basically tell us we have no right to our view on what those words mean. Becoming a party to UNCLOS would help lock the U.S. perspective into permanent international law and give us a seat at the table that would hopefully improve our ability to call on China to act in accordance with the treaty's provisions and to defend our interpretation of those provisions. We're engaged in an unequal bargain right now. We adhere to the UNCLOS terms without enjoying the benefit of shaping the treaty's rules or institutions. Joining the UNCLOS would, at minimum, remove a significant distraction from the discourse surrounding maritime disputes and put the United States in a much stronger position to influence the dynamics in this rapidly changing and evolving environment.
Well, since we are already running short on time, we're going to jump right into the question and answers to hear what our audience wants to know more about. So, Amal Drenzi, I know we just put you in the hot seat. I'm going to keep you in the hot seat for a few minutes here. How many lawyers does the Navy and other services have, and are they on ships?
Oh, when I left the JAG Corps, we were on our way to about 800 strong. The Army is an order of magnitude significantly larger than that. We have lawyers on some ships. Aircraft carriers typically have two for the carrier, and as Admiral Greener talked about, the strike group, that has a lawyer or two embarked on it as well. Amphibious ships are starting to have lawyers on them. So we do forward deploy on some platforms, and we're resident in all of the forward deployed installations. To support the operational law.
And one interesting, I actually just learned this from talking to Admiral Drenzi, the Navy is, I think, the only service that we have lawyers embedded with all of our operational commanders. So at every level of operations, all the way up to the Pentagon, up to the, you know, all the way up to all the secretaries of the military forces, there is military, there's Navy JAG that is actually advising all of our commanders on what to do operationally.
That's true, and it's actually a big help. We're the only service, you know, getting on to sort of the organized, trained, and equipped side, which has to talk to the operational side, right? We're the only service that has a lawyer on the Chief of Naval Operations staff and on the Secretary of the Navy staff. As the JAG, frankly, that didn't threaten me at all. I was one of those people. I was on the Secretary of the Navy staff, and the JAG would leave, and the Secretary would look at me and say, "Is he right?" And, you know, it's better to have good people in the right places. You can coordinate your efforts. You can address issues before they become problems. And you can do what we're paid to do, which is give accurate, timely, and responsive legal advice to the commander.
And we had, before this discussion, I had kind of warned that we might be getting this question, so and this might go directly to you, Admiral Greenert. What steps have been taken to overcome the recent series of accidents involving naval vessels?
Well, the approach, yeah, you kind of put into three camps. Number one, what happened? What we need an accounting of what happened from Admiralty down through the fact that there was a lot of damage and people were killed. So there's the accounting. That has been completed, those investigations. There's an Admiralty investigation for the fact that there were collisions of two ships, you know, a commercial entity. I don't believe that's completed. So that's number one. Those actions result in an accountability, and there are administrative actions going on from courts martial. Number two, there is what were the contributing factors to this? Well, they were tired. The ship should have been more ready. The ship should have been more ready. Why were they tired? And that's kind of a readiness review, if you will. And many of those are underway, but there are hundreds of actions. Number three, looking at this more broadly, why were they not as ready as they should have been? Who's looking over that? What is the chain of command for organized, train, and equip versus operations, which I kind of introduced? When you hand off this ship to conduct operations, who ensures and are they appropriately accountable that these people are, again, certified, they know what they're doing, so that when somebody tells them to go do something, they don't have to ask, gee, I wonder if he, she is able to do that correctly. That was called a strategic review. So there were investigations and there were reviews, and I think we all understand two different legal ramifications to it. So I would say that there are a lot of congressional interest. That's good because as one who testified to the budget and said, I don't have enough and I'm very concerned, and something is going to happen eventually. You can't really pinpoint it. There is interest, increased funding, and lastly, this business that I spoke to about how much, how long, we would say too much, too long is needed, and we need an overall look at the strategy which demands the forces to come forward and deploy for this long. We'd say we're not big enough for that. And it isn't so much we need a bigger military, it is so much you need to look at the strategy and what you're asking these folks to do, because they are not prepared to do it in the way that we demand it be done correctly.
Admiral Gary, I'm going to give this one to you. What is the biggest threat to our fleet? Drones, cyber, new missile technology, integrated equipment, anything along those lines?
Sure. So hard to say which one of those in particular. As I mentioned earlier, the gradations, if you will, of tension, of conflict, has gotten so much more detailed. So I would say the biggest threat is the ability to respond with agility to a series of circumstances that can change faster than ever before. That increases those domains, again, traversing from seabed to space, and then those cross-domain threats as well. It's no longer, you don't no longer have the luxury to just look at the air or the surface or the subsurface. There's a simultaneity of threats. There's overlapping threats. There's subtleties that happen. So it's this awareness. I'd even go further to say that the arms race of the future, or even the one that we're even in right now, is really a race for cognition, about understanding what's happening around you to the point of forecasting, and then you can get in front of it, then you can shape it, as opposed to just responding to it. And that's really where we are now. Capability certainly counts, of course it does, you know, those things, those tangible things, but it's more about awareness, understanding the threats, what's about to happen to you, how do you get in front of it, how do you shape it, how do you play your game and not someone else's.
You want to add to that?
An example. He had it exactly right. A near-term example, I'd say, are cruise missiles. They are made more and more relatively cheap. They are for sale. Many non-state actors, if you will, Hamas and others, can buy them. They come self-contained. All you need to do is set this thing up. You can put it in the back of a truck. In fact, we buy them where we can just bring those babies on the back of our ships in a truck, like in a pack. And these are available now. They're in the Gulf of Aden. They've launched them against our ships, Saudi Arabia ships, Egypt ships. Israel had a ship attacked off of Hamas in the Gaza Strait not that long ago. And so that is an example, just one, where the technology is moving very quickly. The seekers, you know, that they can use longer range right before they go to hit. They do a bunch of wacky maneuvers, very difficult to portray. And as Bob said, understanding that technology is out there, where is it, who's getting it, it has a real legal framework to it. What are the means of sale, and are we looking to preclude them, and by what means are we controlling that? And your own imaginations could take you to other areas. So it's the availability of threatening things to a whole host of threatening entities.
And I'm also going to have Admiral Drinney kind of respond to this. What do you think is the biggest threat in the Pacific Fleet from a legal standpoint?
Well, I think part of it is what we just talked about. I mean, you've got international norms that not all countries are following. And I don't want to make it sound like China's the only one. You know, our allies, some have exaggerated claims. People might claim that we do as well, using an atoll in the Pacific to measure out from some of our claims. But the evolution of the South China Seas from an area of sort of economic resource contention to potential militarization and a place to forward deploy from is very disconcerting. And I don't know that there is a legal regime in place that we all subscribe to that will underpin a future response to that. I think that's the greatest challenge. One of the things I'm fond of saying to my lawyers is, you just get new challenges. Old ones don't go away. There are still people out there with, rocket-propelled grenades on their shoulders shooting our forces. You don't get to just throw away your old knowledge. You have to apply it to new and emerging threats. And the law in some ways needs to develop and catch up to technology. It's happening faster than legal regimes can be established.
One of these questions goes to the differences in the services. We have the Air Force, the Army, the Navy, the Marines are part of the Army, you've got the Coast Guard. Since we operate in such a joint environment, I think the question really goes to why do we still have separate services? Or at this point, are we really one big purple service? And I don't know who wants to answer that. I'll throw it out to you.
I'll start it because we've had discussions about combining certain things. And if there are any Marines in the audience, the Marine Corps is not part of the Army. I'll walk out with you whenever we go.
Did I say part of the Army?
No,
part
she,
of the
didn't, Navy? She didn't say that, right?
Okay, part of the Navy, sorry.
Just kidding. There are certain unique skills brought by each of the services, which if you say, look, we're just going to make it one big joint force, it's been studied to the nth degree, it's too hard to bring them together, to bring those unique skills together. However, there are a lot of, if you want to call them efficiencies or otherwise, that we could do in this regard and pull them together. Some say, why do we have naval air and an Air Force? And say, well, because whenever the concept was brought to the Air Force, they say, so all of these things that Navy Air does, we'd like you to do. And they said, I can't do that. And that transition would take decades, and then other things take over. So this is a consistent question brought up by almost every administration at one level or another when they take over and they assume control, if you will, and come to the Pentagon.
So I'm going to close on this final question. This is probably a hotbed of issues, but I will throw it out there. Obviously, everyone knows the president is the commander-in-chief of the armed forces. The armed forces are part of the executive branch. But I'm just going to say this is my own personal statement. I do believe with the military there is some independence and leadership structure where the military is always trying to, much like the third branch of government, stay above the fray and do what's right. So with that caveat, I'm going to ask this question. How do the statements of the commander-in-chief regarding NATO affect the Navy's mission as stated by the panel?
Well, as a lawyer in the room, I suppose I would say there's what you say and there's what you do. And what we've done has not yet changed. That's a difficult position to be in, I think, when you're trying to talk to our allies and you're separating yourself from like say and do. But I think that's a situation we face today.
I'd have to second that. I think there's style, there's substance, there's rhetoric, there's actions. And when asked similar questions, I say watch our actions and watch the substance of what we do. And I think you'll see a consistency there that's enduring and that transcends the fray, as you said earlier.
Some people have been concerned that any president, including this one, would give an illegal order and it would be carried out because he or she is the president of the United States. And I would tell you that it is very clear to everyone who raises their right hand and they say, I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, and I will bear true faith and allegiance to the Constitution and the country, of course. So you're required to object to that. You're required to, your oath is to the Constitution. And lastly, I would say, I would be stunned if any illegal rule or statement or otherwise got out of the Oval Office, as they say. I mean, there are attorneys all over the place for the right reason, for the right reason. And that would really surprise me. So I use that as actually, I sleep well at night due to all of you. Thank you very much for that.
Well, with that, we're going to end the panel. Thank you very much for joining us today.